I love Mike Hanson Archives.
Did you ready to run?
Vision pole and meet me at the vision hole. We may not get a bite all day, but don't you rush away. What a great place to rest your bones, and mighty fine for skipping stones. You feel fresh as a lemonade, setting in the shade. Whether it's hot, whether it's cool, oh, what a spot for whistling like a fool. What a fine day to take a stroll and wander by the fishing hole. I can't think of a better way to pass the time of day. Call the roll when we get to the vision hole. There'll be you, me, and old dog Trey to doodle time away. If we don't hook a perch or bass, we'll cool our toes in dewy grass, or else pull up a weed to chaw and maybe set and jaw. Hanging around, taking our ease, watching that hound a scratching his fleet. Come on, take down your fishing pole and meet me at the fishing hole. I can't think of a better way to pass the time.
Welcome to River City Talk. My name is Mike Hanson, and we are coming to you live from the studios here at ACTV in beautiful East Austin. River City Talk is a live call-in show, so give us a call here at 477-ACTV or 477-2288 if you want to talk live on the air. May 7th, 1996. We're coming to you live. River City Talk comes to you from 9 p.m. to 10:30 p.m. right here on Channel 16. Let me just say, tonight we have two evangelists from near Fort Worth that drove in to talk to us. And we also have Jeff Davis. He has a little bit of a slant on what they're going to probably say. I would probably say so myself. Let me go ahead and introduce, first of all, we got Joyce Vineyard. Thanks for showing up tonight. I know you had a long drive. And we have her husband, Gary Vineyard, and we have Mr. Jeff Davis.
I'm still here.
And and let me just say about Jeff Davis, y'all don't know him because y'all are out of from out of town, but we've had Jeff Davis on in the past, and nobody have we had any more on the comment line to have back. They've asked for Jeff Davis to come on because I guess he's controversial. I don't know, but anyway, we have him back. We hadn't had you on since November, so, and let me just say, he has
let
his
you,
own.
We have to let you play a little bit.
But you have your own show, and it comes on from 8:30 to 10:30 on Channel 16 tomorrow night, which is Wednesday.
Yes, sir.
All righty. Let me let you go ahead and start off, Jeff.
Well, before I know
what we want to talk about. We got some props here tonight. We want to talk a little bit about the origin of Christmas and Easter and Halloween.
Well, I'd kind of like to get into, if I could.
Well, we can get anything you want.
A little bit about their background, a little bit about organized religion.
Okay, go ahead and tell us what you're all about. And we want y'all to get involved here at 477-2288. We're coming to you live May 7th, 1996. Okay, Joyce, can you start off about a little bit about your ministry?
Sure, Mike. Gary and I are non-denominational evangelists. We are probably more charismatic or Pentecostal than we are as far as organized religion goes. We feel like that organized religion was a result of the crucifixion in Rome, and it was Rome's answer to Christ's crucifixion.
Okay, Gary?
Well, through our religion also, we believe that the Word of God is literal as written,
and that also that he's the same he was yesterday, today, and forever. And we stand on that faith without compromise, without defense for it, because it defends itself, I believe, totally.
What about Christmas? Do you think we should be celebrating Santa Clauses and...
I believe we should celebrate the birth of Christ. To me, that nativity is basically what Christmas is all about. I celebrate every day of his birth, that he was born just that he might come and save this world and not to condemn it.
Okay, Jeff.
Well, let me just mention that first off, just as an opening statement, I want to not knowing you all from Adam. I mean, I just met you all 5 minutes ago. You say you have a structure church ministry.
We have a home church, but we are evangelists. Yes.
Okay. Is your particular church tax exempt?
At this time, no.
Okay. Do you follow doctrines from either the world or the National Council of Churches?
No. Follow the Word of God.
That's it.
See, Now, the fact is, you all might not be exactly my main target, because as far as what I call religious racket is concerned, because there is a lot of phony, baloney, foolishness in this organized religious thing.
Yes.
Okay, so
we agree with that.
Yeah. Okay, so we're okay. Now that we understand that concept.
I believe that Jesus was an unreligious man, and also, you know, I mean, that he was sent to save the whole world as a whole, and that the whole body of Christ is the church, not just one, say, Baptist or, you know, Methodist or whoever. I believe that we're all to be Christians and to live like he did, and then that for, you know, we're as one, not as separate individual little persons. I believe he didn't discriminate in anything in that sort.
Okay, I want to just mention, first off, you are aware that December 25th could not possibly have been Christ's day of birth.
Yes, we do know that.
Okay, you're aware of that.
Yes.
Okay, understanding that, and I guess we were to move to the Christmas element of all of this. Christmas, actually, Santa is actually Nimrod, the old king of the origins of Santa go back to the Nimrod, the king of Babylon.
Yes, we knew that.
Okay, knowing all that. Okay, the December 25th is the day of the winter solstice, the day that starts the two-week festival, midwinter festival of the heathen. Okay, my question then to you, or to, I guess, to any religious person out there, particularly the ministers, is why would you continue to celebrate December 25th, which quite frankly, again, couldn't be Christ's birthday, because he was born.
That's right.
He was born in Israel when the sheep herders were mending the flocks and whatnot. Why would you continue to celebrate this abomination of Jesus and mockery of Jesus Christ with the trees, with the exchange of gifts and all of this? Why is the organized religion still participating in these types of abominations?
I don't have an answer, Jeff, for organized Christianity. I can only tell you that I celebrate Jesus Christ every day.
That's the same with me also. We believe that God gave his greatest gift on that day. Therefore, the only thing we can do is fruits of his ministry and so forth. And we try and offer to those someone every day the gift of salvation. And therefore, every day we try and present that gift as God give Jesus as a sacrifice that the whole world might be saved.
So do you put up your Christmas tree and exchange your gifts on December 25th?
Jeff, I do. So what do you call it? Wait a minute.
That doesn't mean that it's right. So
okay.
What we're doing is we're talking right
okay,
or wrong.
Okay, wait a minute. I want to talk about the Christmas tree. So you're saying if we put up a Christmas tree, what's going on here?
Okay, Christ, it got so bad, it's at least 16 times in the Bible, Christ ordered his disciples to cut down the groves of trees because the heathen were worshiping idols under these groves of trees. This is the origins of your tree. So basically anybody, and also the exchange of gifts. There's only one time in the Bible where there was exchange of gifts in the book of Revelations, where Christ was actually killed and crucified, and the heathen celebrated his crucifixion by exchanging gifts. So when you combine the gift exchange, the trees, the Nimrod, Santa Claus.
Stay tuned right here for more classics on this channel here, Hanson Archives. But to fund this station, I'm offering, if you send us $25, we'll send you a signed copy of Bohemia Grove, Cult of Conspiracy. It was forwarded by Tex Mars that just recently passed away. Also, Alex Jones has a chapter in here. And you know that's good. There's us in our younger days. But on the address that you see, send us $25 and we will send you a signed copy, or give us a call at 830-672-3089 and you can put it on a credit card. We'll send it right out. But that's what we need to help fund this channel, folks. So help us get all the classics uploaded to YouTube. We got hundreds and hundreds of old Alex Jones and Jeff Davis and a bunch of other patriots that we need to upload. About 25-year-old
question. Do you believe what Jeff believes, that there is elitists running this country from behind the scenes? Have y'all ever heard that before?
Yes.
Y'all do believe that?
Yes.
Okay. And that they're trying to, how would you say it, take over power and How would you say it, Jeff? You say it much better than I do.
It comes down to the term New World Order. Okay, that's which leads me another reason why I'm so skeptical. And quite frankly, Mike, I've got to admit, these were not the kind of people that I thought I was going to be debating. It doesn't look like there's going to be too much of a debate, because largely they're in sequence with what I'm saying here. But the fact is,
I'm sure we'll find something here pretty soon.
Well, they've admitted that the Christmas is a hoax, is a fraud.
Well, I haven't admitted that yet.
Well, that's you. But the debate is, you're not in the debate.
But the thing is, I celebrate it because, you know,
because it feels good. We're feeling good right into a new world order. Okay, but now this new world order. Now this is another. If you studied the World Council of Churches and the National Council of, you don't even know where they originated from or what. Okay.
No.
Well, my question then would again would be to an organized religions minister, which you are really or not, is why is there this tyranny pounding down on us under the name of a new world order? And this new modern Babylon is what I'd call it, but yet it's going unchecked. These churches are fighting amongst themselves, they're fighting amongst doctrines, and all of this bickering going on while this modern Babylonian system is going unchecked.
Well, the Bible teaches in the last days there's going to be false prophets, false doctrines, and false teachers. And I think we're seeing those manifest even now today and have been for years to come. And even in the next future, I believe it's even going to get worse as we go on before Jesus comes again.
Okay,
well, and I believe he'll come soon.
Well, again, there's not a lot of, there's really not. I just want to, are you all familiar with Easter and Ezekiel 8? How where Easter sunrise, the origins of Easter sunrise, and these where the heathen were worshiping the sun towards the east?
I know what people set up as basically, you know, saying that, you know, what they're celebrating, but again, it's the resurrection of Christ, the death, burial, and resurrection as far as what they think they're, you know, so forth with. But
the point is, we've got wickedness all around.
That's right.
Okay, and God said, as long as you continue to hear my word and obey my laws, we will be a blessed people.
Yes.
However, if you turn away from my laws and my word, we will be a cursed people. And I would say submit that that's exactly where we're at right now, because we have walked away. We're in these churches. We got a little choir singing and some hip shaking. There's not real worship going on in these churches. They're phony. And as long as we continue to celebrate Easter's and Christmas and these phony pagan holidays, we're going to eat the wrath of God. Well, he's not going to save us.
Can I tell you a little story? We got a caller, I think, online. But can I tell you a story, Jeff? You know, we recently had a prayer service for the Branch Davidians that were killed. I went to my church, and I asked them, could you mention this to the people in the church that we're having a prayer service for the individuals that were killed in Waco 3 years ago. You know that the people at my church told me, no, we will not mention that. But I tell you what, Jeff and Gary and Joyce, they can sure get up there and mention that we're going to run down or walk down Congress for unborn babies. That, you know, that to me is
hypocrisy.
That's exactly what it is. If we're going to have a prayer service for unborn babies, then I think my issue's in church. So you know what I did? I quit the church over that. I really did. I quit the church over that. I won't mention the church on name. So I am kind of getting disgusted with organized religion myself.
Well, one thing we have to learn that Satan is alive and well in this world. And the thing he wants the body of Christ separated and put apart by religions, new false religions, and so forth. And I believe in the same as it was in Acts 2 and the whole Acts that, you know, that the Spirit of God is alive today as it was then and so forth, that through this time that we're getting in now, he wants people to get mad and walk out. Mm-hmm. There's mad churches a mile down the road.
Yeah, but just because you don't go to church don't mean that you can't worship
that's
God.
Right. That's right.
That's exactly
And if
right.
you think that I have any less faith because I quit that church,
oh, no.
that I don't.
No,
do we have a caller on the line? Hello?
Hello?
Yes. Go right ahead.
Okay. Yes, I've been listening for a few minutes, and y'all seem pretty intelligent, and you studied religion extensively, it appears. I'd like to come to you from the atheist point of view. And,
okay.
Just first of all, I'll say that we frankly cannot see why you would pray to basically what is, in essence, a theory. And if you have been able to find any evidence to prove that a God exists, have you been able to show it to anybody, or a God? Can you come up with a God in the first place? Otherwise, it's all very extensive and complex and intelligent and emotional, but it's still just a big theory. And to base your whole life on it, it seems very foolish.
Okay, who wants to start off?
Well, frankly, there's some certain points of atheism that I think are actually, there's some validity to it. The problem that I have with the atheist, though, however, is they can sit there and say that Christmas is false and all. They can tear up the organized religion real well, but they don't do a very good job of explaining why is Christmas a hoax? Why is the fact is these things do have origins, and the Bible is the only place where you can get any of those origins. So just to sit there and say that. And that's true. You cannot. No one's ever seen God, at least other than Moses. Or you can't actually prove an existence. But the fact is, to me, it makes the most sense that there is some supreme power instead of all just coming out of the Big Bang theory. You can't prove that as well. So,
any way you go,
scientifically or any other way, you can't actually prove the existence of it.
That's true, and I am in complete agreement with you there. I happen to be somebody who respects the laws of science, though, and the most important law to me, though, is that if you have a theory, for instance, like a theory like the Big Bang Theory or creationism, the best thing for you to do to try to prove it is to be a fact, if you in fact want it to be a fact, I guess, is to do the research and to find some evidence to prove your theory. Otherwise, basically, if you can't find any evidence that's actually verifiable, then basically science says that it has to remain a theory, and you can't really logically consider it a fact, and that's where religion as a whole, not just organized religion, but religion as a whole, really doesn't wash. I mean, if you ask a serious scientist, exactly what creationism means to him, and it's just a theory, basically. But to really base your whole life on it and then to do some terrible things, I mean, throughout history, religion has caused a great deal of pain. I'm sure we can all agree that wars have
been
fought over it.
I do agree with all that. But that's only because, from my perspective, that's only because the actual essence of the book, which I believe, for one, has been tampered with. But regardless, even if you accept even the basics of the premise of this book, it's man, wicked man generally, in the organized religions, whether it be the Catholic Inquisition or whatever it was that's creating these wars you're talking about. That's men, wicked men, that are perpetrating it, not so much right. as what's in this book
here. But you want to separate the reason from the act and the actor. You know, humans did the bad deeds, true, but the reason is always there and can never be erased, even though you can ignore it all you want. But religion is the reason for many of the terrible things. I mean, the Crusades and the Spanish Inquisition, the Jonestown Massacre, and the Branch Davidian debacle, whatever you want to call it. I mean, if anybody really supports religious people shooting back at the U.S. government for God, I'm sorry, that's just a mistake.
Well, we don't agree with that, sir. I can guarantee you that I don't.
I'm sorry. Then I.
First off, that had nothing to do with religion. So, okay, but go ahead.
I'm sorry.
The point is, the whole religious element, the religious equation, in my perspective, is that the sky is used by the wicked rulers of the days. So you shouldn't condemn the book or a belief in a supreme being just because wicked rulers, like the people that are in control of this world today, the ones that create and finance wars and finance world council of churches and huge religious organizations and this whole religious racket that we're caught up in, you have to hit it at its source, and that being the international bankers and the people who control wealth and have through centuries created methods of fraud to rob and rule over people, and then use the religious racket as a device to get people fighting and quarreling amongst themselves. That's exactly what they're doing now with all these different denominations. They got them fighting amongst all different doctrines and different tongues while they're while they're ruling over the world, essentially.
Let's let Joyce get in here real quick, caller.
Well, it sounds to me like that a lot of what's happening today is exactly what's described to us in the book of Revelation, and you really need to take the time to sit down and read God's word before you decide that it's of none effect, that God is not God.
Well, the Bible was written by man, and Revelation's been going on since it was written and before then. And it's really
how do you explain the fact that the Bible has stood for 2,000 years, let scientists have spent over millions and billions of dollars trying to prove creation?
It's called force. Genocide against anybody or any group of people who do not agree with Christianity, and that's basically why Christianity is the big thing in the United States, because I mean, like the black man, we force him to come over here and be Christian. We force the American Indians to die, and then the ones that live got to be Christian.
Do you have something better to offer?
What's that?
Do you have something better to offer?
Oh, yes. Oh, my goodness, yes. Thank you for asking, too.
Let me just make a point. See, where I think you're wrong, caller, and I appreciate your perspective, but where I think you're wrong and where I think most people are wrong in the whole logic of all of this is that you're still leaving out that element that I've told you about. There are wicked people who use the who actually create these religious systems for their own gain. So you can't. It's like I believe that there are people that are controlling the political parties and keep people in the Democrat Republican camps. They're controlling them through different issues, left wing, right wing, and this whole religious racket is just another element of their control. So you can't necessarily blame the mechanism without at least understanding the brain behind it. You have to understand the brain behind the people who use this religious racket to control and to create wars.
I really think
you can't tear it down into this though and say just because of this is why we've had all these religious wars. It's because of the wicked forces who take the information in this book and other sources and control and manipulate the public through those means.
I think if you're going to think into it that much, you ought to at least ask yourself where the evidence lies and where exactly the God is, because all we have is that book and a bunch of talk and a lot of rhetoric and a lot of shame.
Well, as far as the scientific community.
Okay.
When I went to the Grand Canyon a few years ago, and a little 18-year-old girl sat there and told me that, well, scientific studies have proven that the Grand Canyon was created 18 billion years ago. I'm sorry, my friend, but to me, that's just as much of a phony tale. That could be just as much of a phony tale as any god that's written in this book.
The world's not a billion years old, first of all.
Well, that's what they say.
It just makes a whole lot more sense.
So what do you believe? We came from apes, sir?
Not from apes, no, but there is a great deal of different possible explanations. The thing is, I don't have to pray to anything, and I don't have to beg for forgiveness from a theory. I mean, if you're going to beg and pray to somebody, at least be able to shake their hand. You can't even do that.
Isn't that what faith is all about? Let me ask the preacher.
No, that's what sucker is all about.
Okay, well, let me ask the preacher.
Right, you're bowing down to your government slave masters every day. How come you don't, you're talking about that?
Our government's being run by the Christian Coalition, Tobacco Industries, the NRA,
now
and the Central
Company. Hold it. Now you're absolutely exposing yourself as somebody that, at least on this, doesn't understand what's happening.
Let me ask the.
You still can't produce a God, though. I mean, you can tell him what you want, but you can't prove God exists.
Jeff, let me ask.
I think the trouble with our country today is we start listening to the immorality and so forth, and we're seeking man's knowledge instead of God's knowledge. The Bible teaches to press in. Yes, I found a God on my knees, and I found him, and he's touched me many times.
You don't need to beg to me.
I didn't have to beg to him.
Because I'm real. I'm better than your God. I'm right here. I actually exist. Where is your God?
He's all around us. He's omnipresent.
In your mind. If he's talking
to
you.
No, he's in my heart and my soul.
Your heart pumps blood. And if he's talking to you in your mind, I think you need some help.
Well, I know you do, my brother. God bless
you. Okay, sir, let me get on some more calls. Thanks for calling.
Thanks for your call, my friend.
Yes.
I actually want to say that I have listened to Miss O'Hare on some of her. And she's actually quite right on a lot of the religious, the pagan.
Did she die? Because nobody can find her.
But the fact is, they're actually right on a lot of the.
She's missing.
The
Did you know that, Jeff?
Of a lot of this nonsense that we see today. But the problem with them is they don't give the actual origins and why they're opposed to it. They just say it's nonsense.
Don't we have to have faith though?
That's right.
Okay, is line two on? Did they put line two on for me? Oh, they just gave us something. God knows where she is. It's in the Chronicle. She's missing. Somebody just hand me this right here. Can you get that, Jeff?
Before we press on here, I got a question for y'all.
Okay. Get the newspaper and read it.
Anybody
the
that
Chronicle.
Studied the Puritan age and the elements this country was founded upon knows that it was the religious leaders of that day that stood up against the tyranny of the British government.
Yes.
Anybody that studies it knows that.
That's right.
Where are they today? We have a government that's running amok. We have governments that are seizing people's properties, taking away our rights. And where are the religious leaders today? I mean,
hello?
I don't know if you can answer that or not, but it's a complete.
You there, caller?
First of all, you keep referring to religious leaders, and
so
I think
called.
We've got 900 religions out here and not enough Christians, period.
But where does it say in the Bible that we're supposed to be Christians? Does it say anywhere in the Bible that we're? How many times is Christians even mentioned in the Bible?
Not Paul used it twice.
Twice.
Okay.
But the fact is, look. But do you understand my point?
Yes.
The point is this book. I mean, Moses. God sent Moses into Egypt to free his people
That's
from
right.
bondage.
There's no use
God
to go
doesn't
back to
want.
Egypt.
God doesn't want his people living
right.
on this earth.
Amen.
Slaves.
That's right.
But these religious racket people are allowing it to happen.
But we're going
to
be raptured, though.
I call them the
religious. That's right.
Yeah, well.
You said we're going to be raptured, Jeff, though. And then
no,
we
I don't say that. That's what they say.
do you believe that we're going to be raptured before this new world order comes?
Oh, yeah. I believe before the tribulation starts.
This is where y'all are going to disagree.
Clearly states, behold, I come quickly. And also says that he'll come as he left.
Are they going to put some calls on for us? Hello?
Hello?
Yes?
I have a question for you.
For who? Turn that box up. We can't hardly hear in here.
Hello?
Yes, go ahead.
I was wondering if the two people in the middle could define the word pagan for me.
Pagan.
Pagan is anything that's not of God.
Go ahead.
Not of God?
Not of God.
Okay, because see, I am a pagan, but I feel that I worship God and I worship Jesus. I feel that Jesus was a very good leader. I feel he was a wonderful example for us to live by. I feel, you know, I don't necessarily put him on a pedestal. I feel that he is my brother just as you were my sister, you know. But I'm wondering...
Did you say you were a pagan, ma'am?
I am a pagan.
Okay.
And my definition of paganism is any belief that is non-Christian.
Okay.
I have been to many, many Christian faiths.
That
churches,
makes sense.
And so forth. And
something that's not of God, you said. That's
any belief that is not Christian, mm-hmm. not of God. But my definition of a pagan is any belief that is not Christian. And that's what Webster defines it as, too. But
okay.
I'm also wondering why...
You agree with that, Jeff?
I'm also wondering why does the Christian faith call me the enemy? I mean, I love all of you up there. I'm considered your enemy, but why can you not love me?
Why are you considered the enemy?
Because I don't go according to your rules.
Well, I don't look at you as...
You killed many of my ancestors in the past for their beliefs. Because they would not conform to your beliefs, which I respect, but I did not have that personal relationship with God through an organized religion.
Well, I don't either. So why? I don't know what you're.
I don't belong to an organized religion.
I don't belong to an organized religion anymore either.
Though, and for the definition of pagan, you will find that it's any religion that is not Christian, and I feel that a lot of people. Get a bad rap by being called pagan or heathen, and my understanding of heathen, which is its Latin origin, is those from the heath, those that lived in the woods, or as we would call today, hillbilly.
Well, Jeff Davis had said that Christmas, he has told me in the past when he's been on the show that me putting up a Christmas tree and celebrating Easter, and
these are all pagan holidays.
Well,
I mean the Christian faith had a lot of competition. You know, they had to convert holidays in their own name so that, you know, people would go along with this. I mean, I can understand this.
Right.
To overshadow the pagan holidays. I mean, I have no complaints against Christianity. I believe the Bible is probably one of the best books ever written.
Well, that's not Christianity. What you're talking about, the act of Christmas is probably the biggest abomination of Jesus Christ all year long.
I consider it a celebration of the seasons, though.
Well,
how is that evil?
Well, because, like I said,
I mean, God created these seasons, and they are beautiful. And through these seasons, I can see the beauty of God, I can be reminded daily, and I can drive down I-35 and not flip someone off because they cut me off.
I can tell you.
You know,
why.
I love
you can
these
go
people
look,
anyway.
I understand where you're coming from. You can celebrate the seasons if that's what you want to do. But don't use it. Don't use God, Jesus Christ's name to mock it, because it's got to be the biggest mockery.
I would never mock
of Jesus.
Jesus
and this,
ever.
And let me tell you, this goes against organized religion, because organized religion is in fact doing that.
I feel that organized religion goes against the Bible.
That's exactly what.
That's
my point. So we're really not in that much of a disagreement.
That's right.
That's what I feel. But church, I'm not trying to put labels. But Christian faith, they persecute me for my beliefs.
The organized
religions, yes. That's.
I mean, I can't walk around with a big pentagram on my shirt, which to me represents my harmony with God, with Jesus, with my planet. It keeps me aware. I would never wear a cross, which it's the same as wearing a little miniature electric chair or a little gun or something. I mean...
Well, actually, what you've said, I'm personally not that much in disagreement with you.
But people view me as a Satanist, which I don't even believe in Satan. I believe we are all capable of committing evil, just as we are capable of doing
good. So you don't believe in a heaven or a hell, ma'am?
I do believe that when we all die, we will be judged mm-hmm. in a sort of way, but we will all be one collective energy. I mean, I call it a soul. A lot of people don't like that because they go, oh, you're a Christian. I don't like to be labeled names because people have, you know what I'm saying? The idea is already in their head of what a Christian is. They have closed mind about it, you know. I try to keep an open mind to every religion and every thought because I have learned by keeping my heart open and all those doors open, I can hear God so much. I'm thankful that I'm hearing y'all because I'm influenced by God through you.
Well, my God says, or Jesus says in
our
John
God,
3:17.
Our God, sir, please, our
yes.
God.
But John 3:17 says he came into the world to save it, not to condemn it. And the church that we belong to and the fellowship we belong to, we don't go out condemning others for what right. they do or for what they believe. We believe our God's a God of love, peace, and joy.
Okay, ma'am, let me move on. We got some other calls.
Okay, thank you so
thank
much,
you so much for calling.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Yes, welcome to River City Talk.
Thank you very much. I can barely hear you, but I have a question for Jeff about the Christian holidays.
Yes, sir.
I agree with you about your facts about the origins of the holidays completely and totally, even the Yule log being a sun worship, you know, in the Christmas holiday. But there's also a symbol in ancient Egypt where they would take wafers into their bodies and believe that they became gods with that. Have you ever heard of that?
No.
And some people think that the wafers used in the communion have then become that. And the point I'm trying to make here is that when Jesus set about at the supper with his followers, he changed the symbolism of the wine and the elements to be a Christian symbol, right?
Yes.
Yes.
He changed it from the ancient Egyptians from freedom. He said, now this will now be a symbol for my body and my life that I give for you. And to me, when I look at Christian holidays such as Christmas, I see that as the past, different believers have taken a heathen holiday and said, no longer, we're going to take this and now make this a Christian holiday. We're going to possess it. Just like Jesus changed one symbol and made it holy, we're going to change these other symbols and make that. So as a Christian, when I celebrate Christmas, I don't see myself as celebrating all the heathenism and the past atrocities. When I celebrate it, I'm celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ.
See,
Lord
Jeff,
Savior.
That's what I believe, too.
Well, let me just mention, first off, as you know, it couldn't be the birth of Jesus Christ. That could not be the birthday. The Bible tells us that it has to be, the best guides are like August, September. Secondly, why it's so bad, you have to go back first off to what God said about following his laws. And following what he believes, what we tell him to do, okay. And basically, the laws back in Leviticus, Deuteronomy, that's not a book of about a dictatorship. They're basically laws in there to help us. The food laws, private property laws, all of these laws, which I generally try to adhere to. Okay, God told us if we follow strict to his word and to his guidance, we will be a blessed nation. However, if we don't, we will be a cursed nation. And I think if we continue to sit around in our folly and participate in days on like December 25th that are set up completely around Babylonian origins, trees, gift exchange, and everything that's anti-Christ associated with that day, and then put it under the name of Christ, how are we going to be a blessed nation? This is why we're in it. We're in the mess that we're in. This is why we've got this new world order pounding down on us. If we expect to be a blessed people and a nation taken care of, we cannot. There's no way you can justify this folly and feel goodness that we're participating in, and then turn around and say God's deliver us from
okay,
this,
let's get
this tyranny that's coming.
Let's get
down
Joyce on. Involved in the conversation, Jeff, and then we'll get Gary and. We'll take another call before we go to break.
I would have to say, Jeff, that's a matter of personal how you receive Christ. I mean, how do you do it because you're celebrating something pagan? Do you do it because you're celebrating Christ? If you're celebrating Christ, if he's what you're worshiping, he's what you're thinking about, he's who you're praying to, then I still don't understand how it can be wrong. I think that if you're blessing him, blessing his name, lifting him up.
You just said it was wrong. You just said it was everything about it was the origins were from Babylon.
The origins, yes, are wrong. But
okay,
how
why
is
would
it
you,
received in your spirit today?
Look, if it's wrong and it's Antichrist, how could you participate in it and then turn around and say God delivers from a new world order? When we ourselves, as supposedly his children, are acted in such atrocities, it's hypocrisy.
Okay, did you have anything to add? We're going to take another call before we go to break, Gary.
Well, my whole thing is, the first thing about everything is that we strive to serve Jesus Christ and to be like him as close as we can be. And the Bible says there's none righteous, no, not one. And my whole thing is, I'm going out on the first load when he comes again. I'm not going to be waiting for the second, because I know his promises are simple and they're true.
Okay, let's take another call before we go to break. They might have to put that line 2 on for us. Hello? They might have to put the line 2 on for us. Hello?
Hello?
Yes.
If you don't like organized religion, that just leaves disorganized religion. What would be the advantage of that, Jeff?
I just think that God gave us a book. And we're to study that book and read that book, learn it as best we can, congregate amongst ourselves. But it doesn't have to be. It does not have to be people trained in seminaries with Freemasonry origins.
Well,
it doesn't have to be huge building structures with temples and Nimrod's penis, the old steeple sticking up. It doesn't have to be all of this business, this monkey business that it is today.
Well,
that's exactly what it is. You've
you
got,
didn't say penis today.
Yes, I did, because that's exactly what the old... Every time you go into your religious racket church and you got your old steeple up there, that goes way back to Babylon, where the Babylonians were worshiping Nimrod's penis, the shooting up towards the sun. That's what the origins of the steeple and the obelisk is all about.
Well,
so I don't think that God or Christ or anybody godly that doesn't want to participate in wickedness should be involved in anything like that.
What's wrong?
He gave us a book.
What's wrong with somebody who does understand the book trying to teach it to someone who doesn't understand the book, who wants to teach the book? I don't see the problem.
Because Christ said that many will come under my name and will deceive many. I'm suggesting that the people that are teaching the book, the religious racket people at the pulpits, are not the ones that are the false prophets, or the ones that are deceiving many. That's what I'm suggesting.
The ministers that I've known, it would be like McDonald's. It would be like McDonald's. Somebody going out there on the street corner and start selling hamburgers, believing that they've got as good an operation as McDonald's has. I mean, don't you think that if you're trying to get a job done, that it makes more sense to organize it?
Well, let me ask you, Charlie. If the organized religion was so good, why are all of these problems? You've got a tyrannical government. You've got people in high places running amok. You have a world government body being set up. If the religious organizations were so good and so righteous, why are they letting all of this go unchecked?
Well, it's like the minister said there. The problem goes back to people with, you know, trying to do good, taking religion out of the public schools. I mean, not that they were teaching religion there, but they discredited it through the public schools.
Go ahead.
Now,
we're gonna let Joyce get in.
A few years ago, when you went out there to do business, you did business, for the most part, with people who were trying to live by the commandments. Now you go out there, and the commandments are not in their heart, and they're not in their mind.
That's right.
And who's
I'd
to
like
say?
To hear from
right.
the others
I
there.
I agree.
Okay. But as far as Christmas, you know, who was it, Sammy Allred, that said, "When in Rome, do as the Romanians do"? That's why we worship God, and that's why we worship the birth of Jesus Christ at Christmas, because that's what Christmas is about, worshiping his birth, not the anniversary.
Let me just interrupt.
Lighten up, Jeff.
Charlie, now wait a minute now. Now, that's what we're told that it's for. That's what we're told that it's for. And as far as why didn't we not keep the commandments in our hearts, why should we? We can just go to church, do these churches, and do a little bit of choir singing, some hip shaking, and put on our little bunny hats and our dress Junior up in his bunny suits on Easter. It feels too good the way it is now. Why should we worry about these laws and God's commandments?
Well,
when we've got all this feel-goodism around.
One more point. I used to work for a multinational company, and I had a young man that left the ministry. I can't remember his name to save my life, but I told him that he had to make 10 calls and 5 presentations a day. And he said, well, that's all right. That boy was making 35 calls a day, and he was on his knees with people, and he was trying to help them, and he was listening to their pain. And you tell me that that's not worth something. You don't know that organized religion is probably better than disorganized religion.
I disagree.
I know you do, Jeff, but that's your nature.
Well, in the first place, God's word says that we need that no one teach us. I mean, God gave us, when Jesus ascended, the Holy Spirit was sent to as a comforter, to be alongside us, as the paraclete, to teach us. So I think really what needs to happen here, and it's probably a lot of what Jeff is advocating in a way, is that people need to sit down and read the Word of God for themselves and quit believing what everybody's telling them.
That's right. And it all comes down to read God's Word, period. Even if you look at then I'll let you go again. But if you look, there's no way anybody can justify the Inquisition of the Catholic Church. This is history that has been left out. Millions of people were burned at the stake. As labeled as heretics. Mm-hmm. My point is the people at the pulpits have been trained a certain way of thought. I call them the Obey Caesar churches.
Well, let me ask Gary, where were you taught the Word? We got a line to get to.
Mostly just out of the Word of God. You know, it teaches plainly. Jesus says in Matthew 28 that some had doubted. They'd come to worship and they'd doubted. And he says, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of age.
Let me just read one thing before we go to the break here. People,
we got a call before the break.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay, Jeremiah 10. Have you all read Jeremiah? Now, how anybody could read Jeremiah 10, 1 through 6, and still continue to put up their Christmas tree is ridiculous. It tells you right here, hear ye.
You're making me feel so bad.
Hear ye the word which the Lord spoketh unto you, O house of Israel. Thus saith the Lord, learn not the ways of the heathen, and be not dismayed at them, for the customs of the people are vain. For one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workmen with the axe. They deck it with silver and with gold, and fasten it with nails and with hammers, that it move not. Anybody that continues to put up the Christmas tree just plain has not
read
Jeremiah 10, verse 1 through 6.
So you're saying...
right there it tells you that God's calling it... He's commanding his Israelite people.
Are you telling me when I get my two small children, we go up in the attic and get our Christmas tree and deck it out and all this kind of stuff that we are...
I'm telling you, Mike, is you want to ask me why we're on the verge of eating the New World Order? I'm telling you, I'm suggesting it's because we have walked away from God and we are living in a fairyland. And we're doing things that make us feel good. And we're seeking folly instead of doing what could be preventing us from the tyranny that we're facing. As long as we continue to partake in these feel-goodest activities, God's not going
to
deliver
us. Let's go to one more call before we go to break. Hello?
Hello?
Yes.
Hey, this is the 19-year-old with the big mouth. I want to get what I want to say about religion over with quick, because I don't have much to add to y'all's conversation as far as that goes, but I'm a Frisbeterian. I believe that when you die, your soul goes up on the roof and no one can get it down. Now let's move on from there. I want to talk about the tyranny. I know Mr. Jeff Davis loves to talk about the tyranny. As far as the secret societies of the rich and wealthy who control the organized religion and who control the financial institutions of the entire world.
It's all tied into the same boat here.
Yeah, it is absolutely all tied into the same boat. And I don't like to get millennia fever and think, here comes 2000, society's going to collapse and Jesus is going to come back and all the heathens are going to go to hell or, whatever. But I am seeing a major change on the horizon, and it's not for the better. It's not going to be a new renaissance of goodness. It's going to be evil people taking power. And I know who they are. They're evil men. They're the members of the Committee of 300, the ancient Illuminati, and Freemasonry, of course. But newer, funded by David Rockefeller, all the members kept in check by Henry Kissinger and all his evil buddies, the Trilateral Commission, the Council of Foreign Relations, the Bilderberg Group. Let me quote Barry Goldwater here. He says, "The Council of Foreign Relations is the American branch of a society which originated in England," which is most likely the Illuminati, what he's talking about here, "and believes national boundaries should be obliterated and one world rule established." He continues, "The Trilateral Commission is international and is intended to be the vehicle for multinational consolidation of the commercial and banking interests by seizing control of the political government of the United States with no apologies."
Okay,
that's Barry Goldwater.
Let me just one sentence. That also extends to the World Council of Churches, National Council. See, this is what a lot of your so-called Christians and feel-gooders, they still get sucked into. I want to ask Joyce and Gary,
what do they think about? Do you think you're feel-goodist, or do you think you're doing something good?
I think I worship Jesus Christ and Christ only, and that's that. The people in Jeremiah bowed down to the tree and worshiped it. I don't worship a tree.
But if you put it up on December 25th, you might as well.
Well, hey, I put a tree up too, but that's only because I love exchanging gifts with my family. I'm not trying to celebrate Jesus or anything. It's just a tradition. And no, you're absolutely right, Jeff. It's not about celebrating the birth of Jesus. Of course, it's not his birthday. Christmas is here to keep the economy going, because once a year we need that big boost of Christmas gifts. And without it, our economy would have way collapsed a long time ago.
With your knowledge the way it is, you need it. It's actually much deeper than that. It actually goes way back to Babylon and the World Council.
Well, yeah, I'm talking
about
late
20th century. It's all tied into what
you
were talking about earlier. It's tied into the same mechanism. You'll find the same people that are funding the Democrat Republican Party are bought up NBC. And all of this have also funded the World Council of Churches, National Council of Churches, and all of these front groups, UN and all of them, have their same money base.
Absolutely.
And that's why the religious racket won't touch it.
Right.
That's why they're tax exempt, and that's why they're frauds. Largely, they are very much. Now, you might find a little isolated pocket of resistance to some of these independent churches, but largely the organized religious racket is a complete fraud. It's just like the parties are, like largely the media is, and all the other front groups.
Okay, listen, Jeff, I want to say something about the break here. We're fixing to take a break. You know about the seizure of property that the government's been doing?
It's been going on for a long time.
Okay, well, let me just say this. I recently met this girl that had some mushrooms in the back of her car. Did you know she got a felony for that?
Oh yeah, you can't have them mushrooms.
But anyway, somebody had called in about.
Can I just mention?
Well, wait a minute, I'm setting
there's
up.
Three Republic of Texas members now in prison for her in jail for their political views.
I'm trying to set up this video, and we'll be right back in about 5 minutes. But what it is, somebody called the comment line and left a deal on there about a woman that sent Mrs. Clinton some Indian article or something that's made out of feathers, and they gave her a felony for it. Have you heard about this?
Mm-hmm.
Well, they came and seized a bunch of her property and all this kind of stuff because she picked up some feathers and made something for Miss Clinton. But we got the tape. We finally got the tape to show what the woman's talking about, and it's about a 5-minute tape. And another woman made some kind of art or something with some feathers she found on the ground, and supposedly there's some kind of law that you cannot make artwork out of feathers, which I think is the most ridiculous law that I've ever heard of in my life. They came and seized stuff out of her art gallery. You know.
Well, let me just ask him a question while we let's talk
okay.
about it.
Do we're
you, do you
to
defend
break.
The Bill of Rights? I mean, do you stand up to oppressive governments?
Oh, can
Would
we do this
do that,
before we go to break
just
too?
Kind of not even paying any attention to what's going on around. How'd you feel about what happened in Waco? You think the government should go in there driving tanks through the wall?
No, not at all. I think that's a total invasion of her privacy, but I also think that's just a sign of the times to come before Jesus comes again.
So you do stand up against this stuff.
I think Christians,
well, I didn't know what to
if
I believe that the Lord's going to come again before it gets so bad. You know, I believe he's going to come at that moment. And there's going to be people, you know, I believe you are.
Do you think the Christians should? Do you think the Christians in Waco should have stood up for what happened to these people? Do you think they should have made a stand for what happened?
I think we should all make a stand together for anything that's happening, and that's the only way we're going to do anything for the Lord completely is to stand for Him. And if it says in the Bible, basically, that if He's for us, who can be against us?
We were there to save the kids, but we killed them. We killed them anyway. Mm-hmm. Let me just say this before we go to break. We can get a shot of this. Can we get a shot of this? This right here is my grandpa and grandma. They just celebrate their 60th anniversary. Just want to mention that. Happy anniversary. Okay, we're going to break 60 years. And we'll be back on River City Talk. We come to you from 9 p.m. to 10:30.
Robert Lamadou is a U.S. Fish and Wildlife agent in Ann Arbor, Michigan. Over the course of the year, his agency will seize tens of millions of dollars in personal property. Like this Bengal tiger skin, bought by an undercover federal agent. On the open market, it will bring up to $35,000. Or the horn of a black rhino, ground into powder, it sells for $600 an ounce. Then there are the claws of a great horned owl, popular ornaments for a rearview mirror. From stuffed hoot owls to a smiling crocodile, the exotic and bizarre fill Lamadou's offices. And then, of course, there are bird feathers. Judy Enright is a local artist. In September of 1993, she did just what an artist would do. She created.
I had an old painting that I had done in art school, and it was pretty bad. And I thought, well, before I throw all this out, let's see. I threw it on this floor, started throwing feathers on it, and all of a sudden it just came to life. And I go, ooh, I think I can do something.
Judy says she collected the bulk of the feathers from her backyard, a haven for birds of all types. It wasn't until she showed her painting at an art sale that Judy realized she was not only an artist, but possibly a felon.
Suddenly, three men come up to me, and they look at me, and they said, we're taking that. That's the first words out of their mouth.
When we went up and saw the feathers on the painting, we realized that this was going to be a touchy situation. And we tried to handle it as delicately as possible. But to walk into an art fair and have to take a piece of art from an artist is not something we look forward to in the morning.
That, however, was exactly what Lamadou did. Accompanied by a federal feather expert, Lamadou seized Enright's painting on the spot. Citing the violation of a law dating from 1918, the Federal Migratory Bird Act.
What Mrs. Enright did was illegal. It was illegal to sell these bird feathers.
The first thing that hit me was they're going to drop out of parachutes, out of planes in my backyard and search my backyard. I don't know. Then we have a lot of helicopters that go overhead, and I always wonder, are they up there?
It was a deal that we probably just couldn't walk away from, because if we did, I guarantee there would be vendors or craft workers or whatever in the next art fair that would be selling feathers.
And sure enough, another feather felon came along. This time, her name was Peggy Bargan.
I've had every emotion that you could imagine with this, from stark raving terror to thinking this can't be real.
She made the mistake of sending an Indian dream catcher, a gift made of eagle feathers, to First Lady Hillary Clinton. Although Bargan claims she picked the feathers off the ground at the zoo, Fish and Wildlife was again unimpressed. Agents raided the shop, confiscating feathers and crafts. Bargan was indicted and pled guilty to a possible jail sentence. Spared a similar criminal prosecution, the defeathered Enright could only shake her head, wondering just how far will our government go?
Many people call, you're making this up. You're seeking publicity. You're making it up. I said, no, I'm not making it up. It actually happened. People cannot believe this happened. They're dumbfounded.
You know, I'm a law and order kind of guy. But I did not know that a man does not have to be convicted in order to have his property seized. Now, since this has happened to me, many people have come to me and told me their experiences of their friends and family, where their property's been seized. And they've not even been charged.
Mark Christner also found himself caught in the expanding net of asset forfeiture. It was September 1992, and Fidel Castro had opened his doors, letting a flood of dissidents out of communist Cuba. Christner and his Cuban fiancée, Anna Acosta, were among the thousands who fled. Most sought refuge in the United States. Christner, however, claims he was headed elsewhere.
The people on my vessel weren't saying, take me to Miami. They were saying, leave me alone, I'm going to Mexico.
The Coast Guard didn't buy Christner's story. They charged him with transporting illegal aliens into the United States and seized his boat. Then the government made a second seizure. Christner's fiancée was taken off the boat and placed in a U.S. detention camp at Guantanamo Bay.
I speak with Anna on the telephone almost daily. That's the hardest part of this. You know, the boat I could care less about, honestly.
For more than 2 years, Christner waited, reading letters and watching videotape messages smuggled out of the detention camp. Although he had obtained a visa for his fiancée, the U.S. would only release her back to the Cuban government, a country from which there is no easy exit.
I don't have time to fight for the boat. If they gave me Anna, they could have the boat anyway. You know, I really don't. I feel they seized the boat wrongly, but it's not on the top of my mind.
Some 6 months after we spoke with Mark, he had managed to negotiate Anna's release from Guantanamo and entry into the United States, where they were reunited. The government, meanwhile, sold Christner's boat for $4,400. From an artist in Ann Arbor to the waters off the coast of Cuba, the incidence of asset forfeiture is growing in all areas of law enforcement. And as that power grows, so does the call to curb it. From the courts to Congress, those winds are beginning to stir.
It should anger, it should infuriate every American.
Talk. We come to you from 9 p.m. to 10:30 p.m. right here on Channel 16. Okay, we're going to move on to talk a little bit about UFOs and see what the church believes about that. And we also got a caller.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, Mike.
Ray's on the line. Okay. Jeff, let me go ahead and start out with Joyce this time.
Go ahead.
Joyce, what do you think UFOs are?
I think they're demonic activity to keep our eyes off of Christ and get us confused on and looking into, I mean, looking for answers where there aren't any answers.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Doesn't the Bible mention UFOs?
The Bible says that there will be signs in heaven.
No, I mean in the past, Ezekiel. Have you read Ezekiel?
Yeah, it does. Yeah, it does.
I'll have to let Jeff take that one.
No, go ahead.
Okay. Well, let me ask her a question real quick. Do you worship a cross?
Do I worship the cross?
Yes.
No, I worship Christ.
Thank you. Good answer. So many people worship a cross, and you're not supposed to worship idols. Thank you very much. What was I going to say? Oh, every religion thinks they're right, and if you don't conform to what they believe, then they boot you out. There have been more people died in religious wars, which is really stupid, than all the wars combined. Now, why is this? Do you think God wanted this? I don't think so.
I believe.
And first off, sir, hold on a second. What is God? Do you know what God is? Can you honestly tell me that you know what God is?
He's everything to me.
Tell me, what is God? Have you seen him?
Oh, no, I've not seen him, but I felt him.
Okay. Have you seen a UFO?
No.
You haven't seen pictures of UFOs?
No.
Tell me you have not seen one picture of a UFO.
I don't keep up with it.
No, tell me that you're lying now. Tell me you haven't seen one picture of UFO.
No, I'm not lying. I see what they call UFOs.
Thank you.
But the
thing is, now you've seen a picture of a UFO, some kind of evidence, but you have not seen a picture of God. Now, I believe God exists, but yet you believe God exists, but you have not seen him.
I've seen him.
Now, UFOs have physical evidence that has been left behind. We have all this proof, all this paperwork that our government hands us. And yet, you know, people refuse to believe.
I believe God's. I've seen him through. Where I've seen people leave wheelchairs through his power, and through his grace and his mercy imparted to us. I believe that has to be God. It's nothing else.
I believe that's people healing themselves. You have the ability.
I don't believe that.
You have the ability.
Okay.
You would be amazed what the mind can do, sir.
Let's move on to Jeff. What do you think about UFOs, Jeff?
Well, from everything I've studied, and this is Ray, and I'm going to hopefully be having him on my show here in the next few weeks. But anyway, from my study is the whole UFO. It's not
space aliens. He might disagree with that, but it's not space, or is it some type of pie-in-the-sky demons? It is nothing more than the technology that the World Order boys have.
Jeff, what I'm wondering is, where did this technology come from?
From them.
In the past 20 to 40 years, look how far we've come in technology. All attributing to the crash in Roswell, 1947.
Yeah, I know, but the One Worlders have had the Elf Wave technology since the 1930s.
Well, the One Worlders took advantage of the technology from these crafts that they've downed. Radars downed them.
Well, here's my only, and I think I mentioned this just to you earlier, Ray. My question to people who are just into the UFO thing and not into the World Order thing, it's all tied in together, Jeff. But
the
fact is, you have to first acknowledge that we have a world government body, or actually a world corporation now through the World Bank and whatnot, who are lying to us, who create wars, finance wars, have enslaved us. We tithe to them. They lie to us. They do, but largely manipulate us through their media. They do all these things. So why are we ignoring this clear enemy and going over here and chasing after this possible?
What about the faces of Mars? And let me just promote this, that Greg Erickson is going to play a tape called The Faces of Mars next week, Tuesday, at 7 o'clock.
I think, like I say, the whole UFO thing could be a symptom of the World Order conspiracy.
So you think that somebody went to Mars?
I think that too many of the UFO people are ignoring the World Order conspiracy.
If people, now this is going to sound really ludicrous and everything, but if people will do their research, and I have the classified paperwork to prove it, that we have had bases on Mars and on the moon since the 50s. When John F. Kennedy was making his famous speech, there was a Russian-American alien combined effort on the moon already when we landed on the moon. I have the paperwork. Even the astronauts, Dateline, last 2 weeks ago, came out and said it. On Dateline, national TV, said, we don't care if the government kills us. I aired it on my show last week. We don't care if the government kills us. We know there were beings here. They've been visiting. There were vehicles on the moon all lined up. There was actual bases there. All this stuff was censored. You didn't hear it. They're only telling you what they want you to know. These astronauts are taking their lives into their own hands by saying this, but they lived a good number of their years of their lives, and they feel people have a right to know. Now, why would these astronauts risk their...
Let me tell you, they could be duped as well. See, they could be seeing the technology that the World Order boys are.
They were there on the moon.
Well, yeah, but they might not see. Most of the people that are working for this World Order, Ray, are just doing it out of ignorance.
But you have to realize who the government behind the government is.
Yes, then that's the problem. And most of the people that are participating in it,
right, well,
are doing it out of ignorance.
The best way to take over a world, if you wanted to do it, is not to attack it, but to give false readings and manipulation through the people.
Right.
Have them fighting each other through religion like they've been doing.
They do that.
The same thing with the governments.
Right, they do
and
that.
And the races.
That's exactly what's happening here.
Open the eyes.
And it could even be that they use a space alien too as a mech. You have to at least think that could be an element of it, right?
Okay, Ray, we're going to move on, but we'll make a whole show out of it.
Jeff,
but I'll tell you what, it's very interesting. Look, I actually watch your show.
Cool, you stay
I'm
up that late?
I'm watching what you're throwing out. My only point is this. I don't see why we continue to divert attention away from the clearly seen
enemy. Well, see, I'm not trying to divert attention. I'm trying to get all the information out there.
Right. Well, actually, I got to admit, your last few shows have been excellent with the executive orders, that girl that's on there, and some of the information you all have been putting
out. As a matter of fact, can I bring Stephanie on the show with me?
Sure.
Great. When did you want me to call you?
Anytime. Anytime this week.
And great. I'll call you, too. All righty.
Thank you, Ray, for your show and your work you're doing.
Okay, do y'all have anything to add before we move on about UFOs? No. We're going to move on to some other, unless the caller has something. Hello? Uh-oh. Hello.
Hello, yes. Mike and Jeff. How are you tonight?
Doing fine.
Oh, I'm sorry. I can just barely hear you.
Doing fine.
Okay. Should I turn up my television a
probably
bit?
Probably so. That's probably what it is.
Okay. Let me turn up a bit. Hope I don't get any sort of squealing. I had that one time before when I called.
Hopefully not.
Yes. Well, I had a question for Mr. and Mrs. Vineyard there, and I want to tell you both you're doing a great job down there.
Thank you.
I was looking in my Bible in the New International Version. I don't know how familiar you are with Deuteronomy, but do you know, are you familiar with Deuteronomy 3 and 17?
Yes, some of it, yes.
Yes, well, let's see. I was wondering, first off, fuck Jesus!
Okay.
Okay.
I'm going to read it anyway. I'm going to read what Deuteronomy 3 and 17 anyway.
But we do need to talk a little bit about, was that a heathen?
That's just a man with a desperate cry for help.
Okay. Okay, we cut somebody off while ago. He wanted to finish what he was going to say. Hello? Hello?
Hey, I unfortunately got cut off whenever you took the break. I must say that was very interesting about the forfeitures and seizures. I want to say, Jeff, I will not ignore the world government conspiracy. And I'll tell you about the media, who controls the media. I have here the list of the members of the Council of Foreign Relations and the Trilateral Commission and the Bilderberg Group. They own CBS, NBC, RCA, ABC, PBS, Associated Press, Reuters, Baltimore Sun, Washington Times, Cable News Network, imagine that, Ted Turner,
yes.
New York Time Incorporated, Newsweek, Washington Post, Dow Jones and Company, The National Review, William Buckley happens to be a member of the Council of Foreign Relations.
Let me ask you something. Did you say they own CBN?
The what?
Christian Broadcasting Network. What is that one with Benny Hinn on it?
Well, let me ask you a question.
TBN.
I got a question for you. I want to get his opinion. All right, I want to get your opinion. Do you believe in the space aliens, or do you think that's one of their diversions?
It's more likely one of their diversions. I must say that if it is true, then they're not space aliens from some distant planet with a hyperdrive motivator. That it would, if it's actual, you know, some kind of aliens, it's got to be transdimensional beings. They got to exist in dimensions that we don't perceive, and they can wish themselves to be perceived by us when we want to. I always tell you about fire planes chasing them, and all of a sudden they disappear. They go back to the fifth dimension or whatever, and that's beyond our boundary. I think it's more likely that these are inventions by the government to keep us worried about UFOs and not worried about the Trilateral Commission.
That's what and not only that, it's a good way to disguise the technology that they're building.
Yeah,
just blame it on space.
Hold on a minute, Carl. Let me get into something else.
Okay,
real
don't hang up on me, though.
I know we're not.
All right.
Okay. Let me ask you about what do y'all think about ghosts and demons? Do you think that they're real? That people are actually seeing these demons?
Yes.
Definitely.
Y'all do, Jeff?
I think you could probably look at some Rothschilds and Rockefeller. See, I look more as a physical thing than rather than some spook thing.
So you're saying that nobody has ever seen a ghost or a demon. Why do we hear so much about it then?
Well, I just told you what I think they are, Mike. I think that the real, when the Bible refers to wicked demons and devils and all that, largely I think it's the people that are
in
control of this system.
I think
it's more of a physical.
Believe it or not, that you might know about this, but I went to Fort Worth or close to Burleson and was checking out this ghost trailer. Did you ever hear about that up there?
I've never heard of the ghost trailer.
They had where this blind person was killed in this trailer, and these people were drove out of their home, out of a trailer house, by demons. And I actually saw what was going on in that trailer. I didn't go in it because I was too scared. I saw the lights and the fire and everything else in that trailer. And you know, I don't want to say that it was what it was, but there was actually something going on there. And there was actually a story wrote up about this on on Pat Robertson's show.
I got to say, I think it is possible for someone dies, if they're a wholly evil person, or not wholly, you understand, but completely evil person, that, you know, somehow their soul is trapped here on Earth and all they can do is go around and cause trouble. There's numerous ghost stories and whatever. That's an endless debate. I kind of like to get back evil men running the show on the whole world here. I want to read you a cute little poem that's on my list of the members of the Trilateral Commission and the whole New World Order connection. It goes like this.
No one escapes when freedom fails. The best men rot in filthy jails. And those who cried, appease, appease, are hanged by those they tried to please. And the point being is that all the people out there who will say, oh no, well, he's just one of those crazy right-wing conspiracy theorists or this and that, you know, they're playing into the evil men's hands. You know, the conventional wisdom seems to be that, sure, it's possible that there's conspiracy, but if you have a theory about that conspiracy, it's automatically invalid and there could not possibly be a conspiracy, because we all know that conspiracy theorists are just these crazy people, you know? And
Jeff,
that's got to change.
Well, I can tell you right now, the facts are obviously are so much against the coincidence theorists that, quite frankly, I don't even listen to the coincidence theorists anymore. Because, I mean, there's no other explanation to explain all the phony wars we've been through.
Oh, yeah.
All of the rights, the nation, the trillions of dollars of debt, the rights being siphoned off from us almost daily, this religious racket that's in place and got our minds spiritually destroyed. There's no other explanation to
the revelations is coming true. Is this the time where our society is going to collapse and these evil men are going to come and take over, and that's Satan's plot to come and take over and make this new world government, and then Jesus will come and actually save us good people? Or is it just, you know, happens to be a great coincidence with the book of Revelations? I got to say, 1,000 years ago, everybody was saying, holy crap, here comes the millennium.
And let me just mention, Paul thought it was the end of the world during his period.
Right.
Okay, the point is this. That's not my... We shouldn't be focusing on that.
Well, let's get the preachers involved. Let's get the preachers involved and see if they think it's the end of the world.
If it's the end of the world, so
we're coming to the end of the program.
There's nothing we can do, but the fact of the matter is, we cannot. This, to me, plays right into the enemy's hands. This business about it's inevitable. There's nothing we can do. This is coming right out of your. Right out of your World Council of Churches monkey business. The fact is, we are responsible for what's happening today.
Let's let Joyce answer that question.
We need to stand up to tyrants.
Okay.
Bottom line.
Let's see what she has to say about it, Jeff.
God's word says in 2 Corinthians 10:3, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds, casting down arguments and everything high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Anybody can have a demon that wants one. And right. Jeff may be right. Rockefeller or anybody else can have one that wants one.
Well, but do you think that the making statements that this is the end of the world bit, that plays right into their hands?
It does, because
that's a defeatist mentality.
Right.
Why should we stand up to tyrants when it's inevitable?
True is false.
Okay, let's let Gary get a word in there twice here.
I consider it a victorious statement because, you know, the Bible clearly states, greater is he who's in me than he who's in the world. And the thing is, we don't know the hour, nor the time, nor the day. All we can do is be ready for the Lord's coming. And it teaches that over and over.
We also are commanded throughout this book to stand up against wickedness and high place. In fact,
that's right. Through him.
That tells us that he tells us that we will battle against
through him.
Yes. That's what this means.
Through him.
That's what that means.
In his name.
I'd like to make one more point before y'all got to cut me off. I know y'all are on a time restraint. I want to... if y'all want to let me elaborate for time reasons or whatever, I want to hear, especially Jeff, but all of you, discuss the plans to revoke cash and make us a cashless society.
Oh, yeah, a cashless society. We didn't bring that up.
You got everybody and their mother loves these cute little smart cards, and you just got to run it through the little machine, and it pays for everything. And, of course, we all love to be all in the NCIC 2000. We love to have our photo, signature, and thumbprint in the big computer bank. I mean, this is really setting up towards tyrannical purposes. And I got to say that once they revoke the cash, and everybody accepts it, because they will accept it, because many people are stupid cattle who will go for that, everybody will have their smart card, and it'll be so convenient, and, you know, this and that. And then, according to Government Technology Magazine, October 11th, 1993, quote, the next logical progression from the smart card is a microchip under the skin. It's called Tyrus, made by Texas Instruments.
about the size of a grain of rice. It's so convenient, they just inject it under your skin.
Okay, but caller?
Wave it in front of the radio scanner, and it's so easy, and no
caller,
one can feel you. And
the way I believe that you have to take it willingly. If if they inject it by some means that you don't accept it, I believe that God would not hold it against.
Well, I don't know. It really sounds like taking the mark. I mean, what can you do if there's
It says you have to take the mark. If you do not take it willingly, I don't believe.
Now, Mr. Hanson, you and me know better.
No,
we know this is the mark. So
How do you know they're not injecting this mark into you?
When you go to get a shot, you don't.
Hey, I don't know, and that's why I'm saying
you can take thing out of ignorance. Most people are going along with this world. This wicked world system out of ignorance, Mike.
Well, let me get
that's the whole bottom.
Let me get y'all's comment on this because we don't got that much time here.
Well, again, we're putting a thing. You know, it seems like a lot of people are putting their faith in this world. This world, once you come to know Christ, we're no longer a part of this. We're a part of His kingdom. He promises that, and that His kingdom is at hand. It says for us to repent and forsake this world. And the thing is, I've done that. I put my faith in God. On Him, the rock, I stand. And I believe, like the old song says, all other ground is sinking sand.
Yeah, but let me, you ain't doing what Christ went into the temple and threw the money changers out of there.
That's right.
You're just retreating. You're just ignoring.
I'm not retreating. I'm going forth in faith. I'm going forth in faith.
You're ignoring the wickedness.
Jesus came to save the world and not to condemn it. It's that simple. It's in the Word.
What are you going to do when they tell you that you can't drive your car until you have a transponder on your windshield so they can keep track of you with their cute little radio antennas?
Well, I'm not going to. Well,
well. Jeff Davis is kind of like.
So you can pay your taxes, and no one will have to pay more taxes than they. Than services they need.
Caller.
Driving their car.
Now I agree on Jeff Davis with this. I try to pay my cars off and keep old cars. Even if I have to drive a 1982 truck like I do, I'm going to have my truck paid off. But what they're going to do, I think, is say you cannot drive a car 1986 and below or something like that, and you know they're going to make you get a new.
Get your transponder installed, you won't be able to drive. I mean, and hey,
it's too much pollution.
Hughes Aircraft made a great video. I saw on Access Channel. It's been a while. Two very evangelical Christians talking about the New World Order being the Book of Revelations literally interpreted, and they had a great video excerpt from a Hughes Aircraft, General Motors, also all the heads of General Motors, members of the Bilderberg and the Trilateral Commission, and the CFR, of course. But this Hughes Aircraft video is their promotional video for look at this great convenient way to where you don't have to stop and don't you hate digging for change at the toll booth? And this is so convenient, you know, and everyone will love it. And the company that's bringing it to you is AT&T. Aren't you glad that we'll have the video telephones? Hey, what happens when they're mandatory? I'm sure you've all read George Orwell, but they're setting it up now to be very totalitarian, to where they can take one big grab of power, and the people are going to love it. It's so convenient. The convenience you have to mandate
add one thing here. First off,
we're going to have to make closing statements here.
Okay.
Thank you so much, caller.
All right.
I want to just mention that a lot of these things still are. A lot of it, like with the driver's license and the strip, a lot of this stuff is planned, but that doesn't necessarily mean it'll be implemented as the information, because these people put out misinformation themselves.
Okay,
I just wanted to make, but there's no question whatsoever that there is a global elite in control of things who are planning to enslave only us but the world. And my ultimate question to anybody that says that they believe in this book is, how come they are not standing up to these tyrants like the religious leaders that founded this country did?
Because the religious leaders,
even your attitude is to retreat and ignore it.
My attitude is to attack Satan in his strongholds, and I believe Satan is the tyrant that he's called the Prince of the Air. He's, you know, and I serve the Prince of Peace, Isaiah 55:6 just says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him and to our God. For he will abruptly pardon."
But why don't you become like a Moses and deliver God's people out of bondage?
That's what the bondage is today, is sin in this
world. Don't y'all go to prisons and try to...
That's right.
Yes, we do.
God changes people through His Spirit, through His love, through His peace and His joy. He doesn't teach us to go out and be warring nations. He teaches us to go out and love and peace.
Oh, absolutely. In the Old Testament, that's all God did.
Let me ask you something before we go off the air, Jeff. So you say... You know, I mentioned that.
Let me just respond to him. Hey, and in the Old Testament, that's all God did was tell the old Israelites to go in and the Canaanites, the Mennonites, all of the so-called ites, they went in there and whacked and killed them wicked, them little evil governments.
And most of those,
most of his children
were acting in rebellion because their sacrifices were unholy. So finally, he sent his son, Jesus Christ, that we all might be pardoned from sin, which bounds the world.
Nobody can justify what's happening in this world, this octopus type tyranny pounding down on us, to sit around and ignore this. I don't care what whether you're an atheist or what you are.
All right, but doesn't it all come back to the faith that Jesus Christ in John 3:17 says, "For I did not send my son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved."
That's right.
I mean, you've got to operate in faith in some areas. That's you know, faith, period.
So let me just say this before we go off there. So you're saying my little grandpa here and grandma has been married 60 years, that he went to World War II for nothing.
That's right. He died for no better reason than international bankers can.
Well, he didn't die, Jeff.
Well,
he's alive today.
He's still living. But you said the other night, I heard you say the other night on some show, I guess it was your show, that these wars that we're fighting are contrived by
world bankers. That's
do y'all
exactly
believe that?
Right.
Yes, I do. Okay.
Jesus says, "Render unto Caesar what is Caesar's."
We're going off the air. Thank you so much for coming down all the way from Burleson.
And
what's going to happen is we're going to put your address up. If they want to write y'all, they can. Yeah, we're going off the air. Just go ahead and give you a little closing statement because we're going off the air.
And I'll let them go. I just say it's time for more Moses. I've had enough of this feel-goodism and that God's people are in trouble. The time of singing and choir singing and dancing around these pews is over with. We need more Moses to stand up to the tyrants that are ruling over us.
This is Randall Mock, and I love Mike Hanson's Archives.
Do it one more time. Louder.
This is Randall Mock, and I love Mike Hanson's Archives.
Come on, anybody want to come up here?
All right, that's it.
Who wants to lead it? Let Gene go.
Go ahead.
Yes, sir.
All right. God bless the Republic. Get